So again, let's discuss because I just started the recording, the loads from the seaside, the loads on the berth structure, and the loads from the land side. Now, it is common practice when designing a berth that vertical loads are taken by the foundation of the berth, which may be piles or columns, and very often we have piles of columns, and the reason is that the land it's often not strong enough to take and to sustain the loads by itself. So we need piles or columns in order to reinforce the structure, and this especially for the case of huge berths. Now, the horizontal loads instead are usually taken by friction forces between the berth and the soil and passive earth pressure from landslide. I said that we have to focus on extreme loads. Indeed, loads can be divided into normal loads and extreme loads, also called accidental loads or live loads. Normal load refer to any load that may reasonably be expected to occur during the design life of the structure and under normal operating condition. Extreme loads or accidental loads are instead the load that occur in exceptional situations that are infrequent and unlikely to occur at the same time. So, for instance, if you think at the extreme load that may be derived from a ship that is colliding, that is hitting the berth. This is an infrequent load because usually during the mooring operations, we try to make sure that the ship doesn't hit the berth structure because this is, of course, extremely dangerous. But it may happen. It may happen for mistakes, for extreme conditions due to, for instance, bad conditions of the sea, extreme waves. It may happen that there are ships that may hit the berth. This is an extreme load. Another extreme load may be the load due to an earthquake. But of course, it is unlikely that these extreme loads occur together. And therefore, when computing the design loads, sometimes we use concurrency factors to avoid to add the extreme load to put the extreme loads all together because it is unlikely that they occur together. So we use concurrency factors, which are reductive factors, to be applied to the extreme loads. And other extreme loads may be due to heavy storms, to heavy winds, and therefore, again, concurrency factors or reduction factors are maybe used. By the way, concurrency factor may be used also for normal loads when they are unlikely to occur at the same time. For instance, there might be a load due to the weight of or to the operation, let me say, of cranes, but operation of cranes may not occur when there is extreme wind conditions. So also the combination of extreme wind condition plus the load due to operating cranes, they are unlikely to occur together, and therefore we adopt concurrency factors. Keep in mind that these design procedures are usually regulated by law in force, And therefore, your reference for the estimation of concurrency load, for the also for the estimation of the loads, normal loads, extreme loads, your reference is the law in force of the specific country. We have to look for regulations which are normally established and approved by administrations or by port authorities. You have to look for the regulations in place in the specific country where you operate. These regulations are different, and in different countries you may have different suggestions, and the reason is that in different countries you may have different conditions. You may have in some countries that extreme loads are very unlikely. So it is perfectly reasonable that we have different procedures for different environment and therefore different rules dictated by different countries. So your first task as an engineer, this in general, is to get fully aware of the regulations and law in force. Because also concurrency factors may be suggested by the law is in force. And for instance, I gave the link of the Spanish technical guidelines precisely for this reason, because it's a good example of a technical guideline that give to you some of the indications we are discussing now. I used the term technical guideline. In fact, these technical suggestions may be given by law, or in absence of laws, you have to look for local technical guidelines. Technical guidelines are different from law prescriptions. Law prescription, they are compulsory, you have to adhere to them. The technical guidelines are suggestions. You may decide to follow them or not. The only thing that you have to take into account, if something happens and you need to justify the decisions, for instance, in front of a court, because you have been identified as the responsible designer of a structure that failed. So if you have to justify your decisions, of course, if you didn't follow technical guidelines, you have to explain why. So while the laws in force are restrictive, so you cannot escape from them, you may escape from technical guidelines, but you have to elaborate a sound justification in order to waive your responsibility in case something happens. So looking for laws in force, regulations, and technical guidelines is your first task. And as I said, I gave to you the example of the Spanish ones. Basically, I give to you this example because they are publicly available, and I think they are a very good example. Now, let's talk about the loads. This is a figure that I elaborated to make a summary. I think a graphical summary helps you to get a more comprehensive view. Let me see.
I'm sorry to interrupt, but you are not sharing the screen.
Oh, I'm sorry. I think you made the interruption at the right time. Here it is. Because before then that, I didn't need of sharing anything. Okay, and also I thank you on the chat that you reminded me to continue recording, and this is extremely useful for me. So please don't be shy. If you realize that I'm not recording, just let me know. In this case, it was fine because we didn't miss anything important. So, let's look at this picture then. I think the graphical summary, as I said, it's a very useful aid to get a graphical view of what we need to consider. So, you see the categories, loads from the seaside, loads from the berth, and loads from the land side. And you see the difference between horizontal and vertical loads. They are described separately. And So let's look on the left, loads, horizontal loads from the seaside. We see that these loads are subdivided into three additional categories: from the sea, from the docking ship or mooring ship, just one second, I need to close this window, and from the ship at dock. Now, from the sea, we have to take into account the waves. The waves are originating forces against the structure of the berth, of course, because they are hitting the berth, and we have the load given by ice pressure. Of course, this can be discarded in case we don't foresee any possibility that the sea gets iced. Now, loads from the docking ship. There are the loads that I already mentioned from ship impact and friction, because it's not only the impact, it's also the friction against the softening. I'll tell you later what is the term for these devices that are placed between the ship and the berth in order to soften the friction between the berth and the ship. I will give to you the term later. And also there are the bollard forces. Bollards or bits are the points where the ship is moored. Typically with a rope you connect the ship to the bollards, and of course you are originating forces. During the docking, these forces may be particularly relevant. If you observe a docking ship, you will see that they basically put the ship very close to the berth, and in order to stop the ship, they throw the rope, and through what are called the mooring lines, they throw the ropes, and they put the rope around the bollard in order to stop the ship, therefore originating, of course, a huge traction on the bollard. And these are the bollard forces. And the computation of the bollard forces is quite an interesting task for engineers. And then we have the horizontal loads from the seaside, from the docked ship. Again, we have bollard forces, because when the ship is docked by the impact of waves or the impact of wind, the ship is exposed to waves, it's exposed to wind, and therefore the ship is originating mooring forces on the bollard. And then we have these forces given by wind, by waves, and by currents. Again, these forces are acting on the ship, and the ship is transferring the forces to the bollards. If we look at the vertical loads from the seaside, we have again bollard forces, vertical forces on fenders. The fenders are these devices that I was mentioning before. I couldn't recall the term. And in order to clarify what is a fender, just let me open another window and let me search on Google for port bollard, just to clarify, to get a picture of a bollard. And you see the picture here, and this is an example. You see many examples, and in particular this one. This is a bollard, and you see the rope that is originating a force on the bollard. By the way, you see the caption, marine rope on mooring bollard in port of Podgora, Croatia. And look at the corrosion of the metal there. This is another issue that we will not consider, but it's another issue that is to be considered in the design of births, which gives a further demonstration of the interdisciplinary character of this subject. Okay, and this is for bollards. Now let me search for fenders in order to clarify what they are. Here you can see the fenders. So these fenders are meant to avoid the direct impact between the ship and the berth, and they are fixed to the bollards typically. And you see that there are different types of fenders. Sometimes the fenders are located on the ship side, or they may be located on the berth side. And you see different type of fenders. They are typically made by rubber, and they have to be substituted, of course, because they are subjected to deterioration. So these are the fenders again. And now let me go back. So there is a vertical load, which is originated by the friction of the ship on the fenders. And again, we may have ice forces that are originating also a vertical load. Now, if we look at the berths, so the loads from the berths, again, we can distinguish between horizontal and vertical. The horizontal load are given by thermal dilatation, which is extremely important in the for berth design. We will not discuss this. We have the loads given by cranes. We have the loads given by wind force over the berth. And it may be relevant, especially if the berth has a vertical surface area, vertical surface that is very relevant. Usually, they are not really relevant forces, but if the vertical side of the berth is again significant, you may get significant horizontal wind forces. And then we have the forces against the carbs. What are the carbs? Let me show you again a picture. Carb arbor. And let's see if we can get images. Just one second. No, this is not what I was looking for. So carb port. It's not. Just one second. Let me look for. Okay, here it is. You see, what is the carb? It's usually an obstacle that we place on the berth to avoid that the vehicles go beyond a certain point, to avoid the risk that they may fall into the sea. So these carbs, of course, they have the function of stopping the vehicles, of avoiding the movement of the vehicles into risky areas. But of course, when the vehicle hits against the carbs, you get a forcing. And so you have to take into account this forcing against the carbs. We also have friction forcing. And because when you have vehicles moving over the berth, there is a friction between, for instance, the wheels of the vehicle. When they brake, for instance, they originate horizontal forces, which are to be taken into account. And then we have the vertical loads, berth buildings. Of course, there are buildings over the berth which are originated vertical loads. We may have superimposed load, which may be due to, for instance, storing of containers. And then we have snow load, we may have, and again, ice forces. If we look at the land side, this is something that it's usually we are more familiar with it. It's given to soil filling. The load is given by soil filling. And also we may have load on filling, which means that if you park cars, if you park containers over the soil filling, of course you get an horizontal load on the berth, from the land to the berth. And also we have the pore water load, which means that if the soil filling gets saturated by water, you get an additional load, of course. And the vertical load is again soil filling and superimposed load over the over the birds from the land side. So I hope this picture may help you to get an overall view. This was again redrawn and modified from Thoresen, the book which I mentioned to you earlier. Here I put a quote from Thoresen stating what I already mentioned, namely, different countries have different regulations. All constructions have to be in accordance with the legislation in the country in which it is built. I used the term law in force before, probably a more correct term is legislation. And again, this is extremely important. Many countries have their own standards for marine and coastal construction, but some do not. The designer has to find out whether or not there are national standards, what I mentioned before, or guidelines, what I mentioned before, that have to be used for design. If such national standards exist, they have to be used. We already discussed this. And if national guidelines exist, it is recommended to use them, what we said before. If no national legislation, standard, or guideline exists, this is an interesting case, the designer is not required to use specific design manuals, but it is highly recommended to use internationally accepted standards and guidelines instead of trying to create a specific guideline for the project. This is crystal clear, and I think should be carved into the stone to give you a very practical guideline on how you have to move, how you have to manage a birth design. And here it is mentioned that in particular Euro codes and national regulation may give orders of magnitude or more specific indication for concurrency factors and individual loads. For instance, in Italy, we have national legislation that, depending on the Italian region, gives to you the snow load, also depending on the slope of the surface. So in Italy, I may give you some indications, and I'm sure that in other courses you already got indications about the legislation which dictates the procedures that you have to use. Keep in mind that getting this information related to legislation, related to existing guidelines, it's a step that it's not easy. It's not easy because, especially for port design, you know, it's a kind of professional activity that it's not very usual. It's not like designing a house where you have plenty of information to get all the existing guidelines. In this case, it's not so easy to find the information. And keep in mind also the suggestion of using international standards. Now let's discuss a little bit more about the combination of loads. And a load combination results when you put together more than one load on a structure. And in this case, you have to use, as we mentioned, the concurrency factors. National legislation and international guidelines may give to you some indications about the concurrency factors, about what kind of loads you may consider acting together. Because for sure you cannot make a simple sum of all the loads, of all the loads that we discussed, because you would end up with an unsustainable project. You have to keep into account that, you know, it's absolute safety never exists in engineering, and absolute safety is impossible to reach because the structure should be so oversized that it would become impossible to realize it because of the cost, because of several implications that we cannot brings us to avoid to oversize any structure that we design. The task of the engineer is to correctly size a structure, and oversizing is not a solution. And here I am listing two guidelines that you need to consider when you have to decide the combination of loads that you should better adopt. First of all, you should take into account that live loads, which means accidental loads, as we already mentioned, are unlikely to occur at the same time. And in particular, it is unlikely that more than two of them occur at the same time, unless they are dependent each other. Okay, so for instance, in some cases, you may have the additional load given by wind and by waves. They are dependent. So it is likely that when you have wind, you also have waves. So if you consider the accidental load given by extreme wind plus the accidental load given by extreme waves, this is not unlikely to occur. And therefore, the suggestion is try to see what happens if they are occurring together. In other cases, if you consider, for instance, the accidental load given by wind and the accidental load given by earthquakes, they are unlikely to occur together. And therefore, in this case, you shouldn't combine more than two of them if they are unlikely to occur together. And this is a suggestion that you should take into account if you don't have any legislation or any guideline suggesting what is the best combination of loads. And also keep into account that when designing berths, usually the seismic load is considered an accidental load. So it's not a normal load. And while for buildings, it may be different. For buildings, in some regions, the seismic load is considered a normal load. But for designing berths, usually it's considered an accidental load. Of course, you have to look at the legislation first, and these suggestions that I'm giving to you, you have to treat them like the international standards that I mentioned before. And again, we are referring to this Spanish standard, which is a good example for giving to you an idea of the accidental loads that may be combined together. Any questions so far related to these loads? Let me have a look at the chat. Okay. Now, let me talk about design life.
Professor.
Yes, please.
I have a question, like on the harbor, when the ships come to the port, we also know that there is sand in the depth of the water, which also accumulates at the harbor. So is it like that the more and more sand comes and it puts more load on the deck or berth?
I wouldn't say that the sand is causing more load. What the problem related with the sand is that if it accumulates a lot, it may become an obstacle to the mooring ship, to the docking ship, and therefore you may need to remove it by dredging. On the other hand, there is another problem related to the sand, which is the fact that the sand is often a mud and it's contaminated. It's a mud because even if it's originally sand, then it may attract and collect some pollutants released by the ships, like oil, like other kind of garbages. And therefore it becomes a contaminated mud. And once that you dredge this contaminated mud, it is a problem to dispose it, to displace it, because it's contaminated and therefore needs to be treated before displacing it. I will mention this problem later on at the end of this lecture, but definitely I wouldn't say that it's originating a load, because you cannot allow an accumulation, a strong accumulation of sand. And also you have to take into account that this would be saturated sand, which is not making any pressure over the berth, because it would be sand that moves back and forth from the sea and the berth, but it's not really accumulating and exerting a pressure. So I hope this answers your question, but indeed the sand is a problem for the two reasons that I mentioned. And in fact, dredging is frequently operated, is a usual practice in port management. For instance, for the port in Ravenna, there is a lot of sand in close to the coastline, because it's a sandy beach, it's a sandy coast, and they need to frequently dredge the port with the problem of mud displacement afterwards. In fact, to give you an information, we are now launching this new degree program in harbor engineering. It will start next September, and one of the subjects that they specifically asked us to include is mud treatment, because they have this problem. When they dredge the mud, they have the problem of displacing it in the land, which is a problem.
Thank you, Professor.
Yeah, thank you for the question. Any other question? So, design life. This is a common question in civil engineering. When we design a structure, we have to fix the design life. Why it is important? It is important because when you design a structure that is expected to have a long life, this means that your plan is to predict, you are predicting a long interaction, a long in time interaction of the structure with the sea, for instance, a long in time interaction of the structure with the ships. The longer this interaction is, the higher the probability that an extreme load occurs. For instance, if you designed a berth, hypothetically, this is a fiction, for a design life of 1 week, it is very unlikely you realize that in 1 week you get an accident of a mooring ship hitting the berth. It is very unlikely that in 1 week you get an extreme storm. If you design a berth with an expected life of 100 years, it becomes quite likely that at least once during the time span of 100 years, you get a ship hitting the berth. It is extremely likely that at least once you get a very extreme wind, a very extreme storm. So the design life becomes important for defining the accidental loads, because the accidental loads, the live loads, are estimated usually in probabilistic terms. Like, for instance, if you have to estimate an extreme wave height, you know that you fit a probability distribution in order to get the expected max wave height during a certain period. So you need to estimate these loads in probabilistic terms, and instead of referring to probability, you refer to, in engineering, to the so-called return period. So what is, let me see if I included the definition of return period. No, so I shouldn't provide a formal definition because it's not provided here. So let me just provide the concept. So I said, instead of probability, you refer to the return period, which means that you refer to, if you have a birth with a design life of 100 years, you refer to the max wave height you are expecting during a period of 100 years. And this max wave height is higher than the max wave height that you expect for a shorter period, like 10 years. So defining the design life is extremely important for defining the time step with respect to which you estimate the extreme load. Now, a general design rule is that the birth structures, the ordinary birth structures in commercial port, should have a design life of at least 50 years. Let's say that if you refer to particular situation, like for instance berth serving special industries, container traffic, oil traffic, you may decide to choose a shorter period, like 30 years. Why is that? Because you have to really try to understand if you don't have a legislation giving to you indication, because sometimes the design life is given by legislation. If you don't have this indication by legislation, you have to figure out what could be the duration of the activity your structure is planned for. So if it is ordinary activities like mooring ships and with reference to something that is expected to last along, then you take 50 years. If you instead design for oil traffic, it's unlikely that your design is going to last for 50 years because there will be an evolution of the use of oil, both in negative or positive term. We may increase the use of oil, but it is more likely that we decrease it. So if you have changes in your societal organization, changes in the economy that suggest that your structure may work for less than 50 years, you may reduce the expected lifetime. Because, you know, industrial traffic is subjected to change in a relatively short time. But for other more important works, like flood protection works, I mean marine floods, then you should probably consider a longer design life. Why is that? Because, you know, for flood protection works, you have an implied risk due to the failure of the structure, which may cause the death of people. So you have to be more careful. When you foresee that the life of people is at risk, the related design should adopt safety factors that are higher. And this is why for flood protection works, we suggest 100 years or more. As a rule of thumb, for these structures that you see here, we suggest this expected design life for a breakwater, which may be a flood protection structure, it's 100 years. for reinforced open berth structures, 5100. For steel sheet pile berth structure, which means a berth structure that is founded, has the its foundation on sheet piles. Sheet piles are given in this picture here. You see the brown vertical sheets are sheets pile, sheet piles, and they are the foundation. They go deep into the soil, into the sea bottom, and they are the foundation of this berth. So for this steel sheet pile berth structure, 50 years, rubber fenders, 10 years, because it's not a big problem if a rubber fender fails. Concrete aprons and rods, 20 years. And again, you should refer to the national guidelines. I am already 5 minutes late. I would like to stop for 15 minutes and then we go on for 40 more minutes. Any questions so far? Thank you. So let's make another break.